So we are going to talk briefly on the sacrament of penance and reconciliation. And we shall ask ourselves again, what is this sacrament? And we know that it's a sacrament by which the sins we commit after our baptism are forgiven. Because we are all sinners. And even after we have been cleansed from original sin through baptism, and even for those of us who were baptized as adults, for both our original and actual sins, we continue to sin every day. And so God, who is always ready to bring us back to Him, who knows the effects of sin on us, in our lives, and in the community, gave us this sacrament so that anytime we sin, we can come back to Him and reconcile with Him. And so the fruits and the effects of this sacrament comes from the name itself. And the name is Sacrament of Penance and what? Beautiful. So reconciliation. When we sin, we have cut ourselves away from God. We have marred the relationship we have with God. And so by going for confession, you are asking for reconciliation. Because the sacrament itself is a call. It's reminding us that we have to constantly answer the call of confession. We are being called to always repent and believe the gospel. Repent and come back to God. And so when we sin against God and we go for confession, we are trying to reconcile with Him. And so after our confession, we feel free. We know that our relationship with God has been brought back to life. Are we together? Hello? So that's the first. And that way we are also saving our souls, because by our sins, especially our mortal sins, we are dead spiritually. And we deserve eternal punishment. But by going for confession, we are able to be redeemed once again. Then also, another effect of this sacrament is that when we sin, we have also injured the church. We are children of the church, so our sins are also against the church. Our sins are against our neighbors. And so, by the sacrament of reconciliation, we are also brought back our relationship, we are reconciled back to the church, we are reconciled back to our neighbors, our families. And our sins damage we ourselves. We are really not in connection, our connection with our souls is divided because of our sin. We are not really at peace with ourselves when we sin. And so our going for confession reconciles us to ourselves too. We are able to come back to ourselves and realize that I am going the wrong way and I must come back to the truth. And so you are always encouraged to visit the sacrament, to avail yourselves, because it is an opportunity each day to not lose your soul, to be able to continue your walk with God. And through this sacrament, you are giving the graces you need to fight again. Because we must keep fighting this battle for holiness, battle to please God until the end of our lives. And so the sacrament reminds us that when we fall, we must what? And so you are reconciled with yourself, you are given the grace to continue fighting, to continue on the path of holiness. And so we ask ourselves, what are the conditions necessary to make a good confession? Which is something we all know. The first is what? The first condition, somebody saying it, be bold. Contrition. All of us, what's the first condition? Now what is contrition? It's a time of examining yourself. You look into yourself, you realize the sins you have committed, you know the gravity of what you have done. You have said to yourself that by that come back to ourselves, know the gravity, examine your conscience, be able to look into yourself, feel sorrow for the sins you have committed, and have a deep and strong purpose to amend yourself. A firm resolution not to go back again. That is contrition. Then the second condition is what? Confession itself. Now you approach the priest and confess your sins. And you don't go hiding sins. You don't go to the priest thinking that because he may know you, he may see you somewhere else. Or you think that what you have committed is so strong, and so because of that, you think of which one to confess. Then the ones who hide, that will ordinarily say, you know you remember, but you say, for these and the ones that are forgotten, I ask for pardon and absolution. God sees your heart. That is not a perfect confession. You know you're feeling something intentionally. If you are going to God, you have to believe that He's ready to forgive you all your sins. And we know that the seal of confession binds every priest not to disclose anything he hears in the confession. So why are we afraid? You have to go and open up to God, because the priest is there in the person of who? So he's not forgiving you by his own power. It's a power that has been given to him. Then the third is the penance for satisfaction. And then we are given what to do. Sometimes we are told to say some prayers. At other times, we are told to do something. We are forgiving our internal debt. By going for confession and being absolved, your internal punishment is taken away. You are doing this, the penance given you, as a satisfaction for the wrong you have done in the possible way you can as a human being. You are not paying for your eternal debt. God has forgiven you. It's another way of just showing deep sorrow for what you have done and repairing to the best of your ability your relationship with God. And so when we are giving these, we should also do them diligently. Because I've also heard of stories, some people go to priests after confession, they are giving their penance, and they think, no, this one is too much. And they run to another priest. At least one person told me he was asked to say 3 decades of the rosary. And for her, it was too strange. And so, and too much, because what she has known is one Our Father, one Jesus. And so the next thing is that she ran to the next priest. Let's do it wholeheartedly, knowing that what we are doing is our own little way of showing sorrow. Like I said, you can't pay for your sins, and God has forgiven you. Then the last of the conditions is absolution. By the power given to the priest by God, he is able to give the judgment, and this judgment is a judgment of freedom. He lifts his hand and tells you that by the power given to him, he takes away your sins. And so you go, instead of coming, you usually go to a court to be given your punishment when you are guilty. But in this instance, after confessing your sins, you are told to go free. Go a free man, go a free woman. Why would we be hiding from this sacrament? Quickly, we ask ourselves, I think this is one of the basic questions. Why must I go to a priest? From where does this power come from? Who gave them this power? Why must I even confess to a human being? And usually, like I said, the argument is not about the forgiveness of sin, because we really don't have the power to do everything. But sometimes we also forget that He has promised us, Jesus said that those who believe in me will do greater things than I have done. And He gave the apostles the power. So we see in Matthew chapter 16, verses 18 and 19, which says,
Matthew chapter 16, verses 18 and 19. And so I tell you, Peter, you are a rock, and on this rock foundation, I will build my church, and not even death will ever be able to overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. What you prohibit on earth will be prohibited in heaven, and what you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven.
Thank you. Let us simple question. If holiness is what will gain us entry into this kingdom of God, what will make it be blocked for us entering it? What is that thing that will now make the doors of the kingdom be closed to us? Let's start for if we know that what will cause us to be kept outside the gate, outside the door, is our sin. What power is that? If somebody has been given the power to open the door to you. So, through Peter and speaking to the apostles, Christ has given these keys. And that keys which shows authority, which shows jurisdiction, also connotes this forgiveness of sin. Because it's that same sin that will keep us outside. Are we together?
Yes.
Then quickly, also John chapter 20, verses 22 to 23.
John chapter 20, verses 22 to 23. Then he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive people's sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven."
There's something beautiful you should note here. That passage from Matthew was before the death and resurrection of Christ. The one of John was after the resurrection. And we know that Jesus Christ came as man to the earth to die to save us from our sins, right? And even before his death, he gave Peter and the apostles this key. He gave them this power to forgive sins. After his death and resurrection, he still gives them, he breathes on them, gives them the Holy Spirit, and tells them that whosoever you forgive is what?
Amen.
And so, by apostolic succession, this has come down to our priest of today. And so a priest, every priest who has the faculty, can say to you, "I absolve you of your sins," and doing it by the power given to him by Jesus Christ. So no priest does that by himself. And like I said, you do not fear that somebody is going to use your sins against you. Because any priest that does that will be reported, the faculty taken away from you. Then finally, because of time, there is this pressing question, especially that has arisen, especially because of this COVID moment, and sometimes some people ask, why can't I go for confession through the phone or on the phone? And it's the same thing I just ended with. The confessional seal, there's supposed to be great secrecy in the confession. Like I said, the priest is not supposed to disclose anything you have said. And to ensure that the sacrament does not admit of a third party, what is it? That somebody else apart from the priest, you are the first person, the priest being the second, somebody else apart from two of you should not get together. And so when you use the phone, even the telecommunication itself is a third party. Nobody can assure you of secrecy in that instance. And so the church is completely against it. And that is why in periods like this, we say that perfect contrition, when you are, we call it physical impossibility. There are two things. One is moral impossibility. When, for example, the person you are going to, the priest you are going to, is a kind of accomplice in what you are, the sin you are going to commit. Let's just give a rough sketch, like you went to steal with a priest. And because it's a priest afterwards, you want to go to confession. It's not right. as opposed to go to another place. So that is a moral impossibility. Then there's a physical one, which is like what I said, during the COVID period, we were all encouraged to stay at home. Maybe there's war, something that won't allow you to go out to see a priest. And because of that, you have the situation whereby you have a physical impossibility. And in that instance, phone calls, like I said, is still not allowed. The only thing is, or the only perfect thing you will do is to have a perfect contrition. And God, who knows our hearts, will continue to forgive us. We are approaching in sincerity. Let's hold the power of this sacrament and let's continue to make use of it. Thank you.